microcirculation imaging. I guess this is a very, very important and interesting angle. I am not for advertising, but I have an example, and if you like, I will see it and spend it to you. I ask you. Okay. Martin, it's your turn.
Thank you very much. And thanks everybody for coming along. This book, of course, is not really my work. It's a collection of the work of the experts in the field and their opinion and knowledge of microcirculation imaging as it is today in all of the different areas, all of the different ways we can access the microcirculation. And even since we published this a couple of years ago, things move along very quickly. Just to give you an idea, I'm coming from Galway. Used to be the edge of the known world, I suppose. Although it was useful because, when all of Europe went into the Dark Ages, they never bothered to come to Ireland, so we were able to repopulate the knowledge we got back into Europe. And now, I guess I'm back here for similar kinds of reasons. By the way, it takes a few days, apparently, to drive to Szeged. And luckily, there's no roadworks in Hungary or in Ireland, so we have perfect roads on both ends, but everybody else has got really bad roads, as you can see. So only 27 hours to drive, not too bad. Okay, so I'm going to talk about many different types of microcirculation imaging, and I would really like to encourage you to ask questions as we go along or afterwards. And for anybody who doesn't ask a question during this session, you have to buy me a beer later this evening. So I'm expecting a lot of questions then. Right? This is not working. It's still working. So in my laboratory, we are trying to apply many different types of microcirculation imaging, and to provide this essentially as a service to people who want to investigate, people like yourselves who want to investigate physiological and pathophysiological manifestations of microcirculation within living organisms, be they animals or humans. And there are many ways that we can tackle to do this. I started off with laser Doppler and moved on to using other techniques, mainly because we start with laser Doppler with a point measurement, then we move to imaging because imaging becomes much more interesting, comparing what's going on in different areas of the tissue. When we had imaging with laser Doppler, that was quite slow, so we moved to laser spectral imaging, a faster form, but perhaps not as as theoretically sound. And then both of those are quite dependent on movement, because of course actually they're measuring movement, and so we move to tissue viability imaging in a collaboration with the originator of PERIMED, and I see there's a representative of PERIMED in the background, Gert Nielsen, who became initially an opponent of mine because we started a company called Oxford Optronics, developing competing technologies in laser Doppler, but got together to develop this tissue viability imaging system, which is not dependent on motion, but it doesn't give you flow, it gives you a map of concentration of hemoglobin or blood within the system. And then the difficulty with those techniques is that you don't have any depth information. So the physiologists and medical people always asking us, well, at what depth are you measuring? And we say, well, not exactly sure. Probably the first millimeter of tissue. We are sampling from all of that. But they really say, well, we don't know, is this really a nutritional flow? Is it thermoregulatory flow? What compartment of the tissue, what do the vessels look like within there? So then we got interested in optical coherence tomography, because a few years ago it became possible to do tissue imaging with optical coherence tomography. Until then, it was mostly used in the eye. And of course, the eye is quite simple because there's no very little scattering going in and out of the eye. It's designed, after all, to transfer light in and out. So to get a depth scan in the eye is not so difficult. But in tissue, you have to move to longer wavelengths, and I'll try to explain why that is. And then you could use optical coherence tomography in skin and brain and so on. But then this is limited to 1 millimeter, so we move to photoacoustic imaging, which can see deeper within the tissue. So I'll try to talk about all of those techniques as we go through this this afternoon. And but please do stop and ask questions as we go along. Remember, there's a penalty for those. Okay. So, by the way, the region of Ireland I come from, Galway, is a medical devices dependent region, if you like. We have a lot of, it's a very small country, Ireland, about 5 million people. We do have concentration on a small number of topics, and I think that's important wherever a region wants to think about where its future is going. You can't be an expert in 12 things. You can be an expert maybe in 3, really pushing it 4 or 5, but certainly not more than 5 things. So anybody who tells you they're an expert in more than 5 things, you really have to question what's going on. But medical devices is one of the things that we try to focus on in Ireland. And just to show that we've been at optical engineering for quite a while now, here is Newgrange. It's essentially a tomb, or at least we believe it was a tomb that was built 6,000 years ago. So 900 years before the pyramids in Giza, 300 years before Stonehenge in Britain, which essentially is a pile of stones that is arranged more or less in this, but it doesn't have the roof on it, and it doesn't have this nice quartz facade that these people put here in Ireland. So about 6,000 years ago, they built this light box. Quite a piece of engineering. When you think that people only lived for maybe 25 or 30 years, they didn't write things down. They built a light box which operates for 15 minutes every year. 15 minutes every year, the light comes in through this hole here, goes right through to the back of the tomb, and presumably, if there's a pile of bones or a body there, the chief or whoever it is, presumably important person, gets transported to some other life or whatever was the idea at the time. The only other thing we know about them, because they didn't write things down, was that they were most likely on psychedelic drugs. And the reason we know that is apparently these kinds of drawings are typical of people on psychedelic drugs. That's more your department than mine. But in any case, about 6,000 years of optical engineering. And we have lots of companies now, I suppose, dependent on photonics for making very fine medical devices like Medtronic and Covidien, Boston Scientific, all those large and important companies which give us, I suppose, a context for our work. Some of the companies will be familiar to whoever's in the audience who's involved in imaging and putting imaging systems together, like Pandor Technology, for example, making scientific cameras. One other thing I want to mention is the International Year of Light next year, and we have a European project promoting that, so we'll be doing some things associated with it. So back to microcirculation imaging, and I'm going to start here in the 1960s, although I will mention in a minute that it started quite a long time before that. But in terms of scientific publications, when I draw this graph, this is what I see, that it started in the mid-1960s. And I was lucky enough to do my PhD by accident in Oxford, and my supervisor was a guy called Terence Ryan, who turned out later to be a very famous professor, but I didn't know that at the time. Published an article in 1966, actually before I was born, on the microcirculation. And you will see that this activity around the microcirculation really took off in the late 60s and early 1970s. Does anybody know why it would suddenly take off in the 1970s? What happened in the 1970s?
Leahy was invented.
Pardon?
Leahy was invented.
Laser was invented in early 1960s, yeah. That was important. But they weren't using lasers yet for microcirculation imaging. Were this? Okay. Doesn't have anything to do with people coming off psychedelic drugs at the end of the 1960s, right? There's a hint. What else happened in the 1970s? TV, right? TV became popular, the ability to record video and therefore from frame to frame look at the movement of cells within tissue, so you could actually get a velocity flow during that time. So there was a takeoff, and then really very fast, rapid takeoff. I mean, this is a lot of publications way back when, you know, there weren't as many journals and not as many people publishing papers. And then it sort of flattened out for a bit. And when our friends in Perinet and Oxford Optronics and Moore Instruments got involved, it started to take off again in the 1980s and early 1990s. We had imaging, and then very recently we see that, you know, in all fields, in the clinical applications, this laser pointer isn't very bright, so maybe I'll use this thing here. So we see that in the clinical papers or the general papers, there isn't such a massive increase. But here, in the engineering and physical sciences, there's a huge increase in activity over the last couple of years. And it turns out that this is because we have now gone to three-dimensional imaging and four-dimensional imaging in the microcirculation. So the applications haven't really taken off yet, but I think that the technology is there to allow us to discover new things and new reasons for using those technologies. And in fact, there is right throughout history, from the discovery that the Earth is not the center of the universe and so on by Galileo, technological advancements have allowed us to see totally new things that we didn't expect to see before. And hopefully something similar will happen with your attosecond laser facility. I'm sure there are many things that you will discover that you never thought you would apply that facility to. Here's an example. In the 1600s, in Holland, a guy called Van Leeuwenhoek, who was actually, I think, a tax collector, would spend his evenings making lenses and make smaller and smaller, basically, balls of glass. And if you make the ball of glass smaller and smaller, you get a shorter focal length or a stronger focus, a higher numerical aperture, or lower numerical aperture, as we would say in physics and imaging. And if you do that, suddenly you can see things small enough so that you can see cells. And you can suddenly see cells, and it will see cells moving within objects. And Malpighi over in Bologna used that to look in the frog's lung, and here's one of his drawings from that time. And he was able to see for the first time blood cells going from the arterial side to the venous side within the lung. And unfortunately, William Harvey had died, but this proved his theory that blood flows from the arterial side to the venous side through these small capillaries that we've been hearing about in the last course. So this was only possible because you had now a lens with the right numerical aperture, the right focusing power, that you could see those things. And here are some of the drawings from Van Leeuwenhoek at the time, looking very, very similar to what we now see in a modern microscope. In fact, I often joke with my students that if they could see blood cells and render them so nicely from within living organisms, of course this is from outside of a living organism, if they could see within living organisms as nicely as this, I would be very pleased with their imaging systems. So the question then is, why don't we see deeper within the tissue? And there are lots of things that happen when you put light into tissue. And I suppose, being very practical, I like to think about, well, let's try it. Let's shine some light through my finger and see what happens. And basically, this is what happens if you shine light through your finger. You will see, if you try to shine blue light through your finger, you will see almost nothing. So almost nothing will come through. If you shine green light through your finger, you get quite a lot more coming through. And if you shine red light through your finger, you get an awful lot of light coming through. So about 1 centimeter of tissue, including a bone, you get a lot of light through. So, question for you. What do you see in this image that tells you about light interacting with tissue? What can you conclude from what you see? Or even all three images? What do you conclude? Anything? Well, I've told you one thing you can conclude, right?
Well, the blue light is absorbed by the skin.
It's very strongly absorbed by the tissue, not just the skin, but the blood as well, within the tissue, yeah. Is there anything else about this picture that strikes you as strange? What imaging modalities are you most familiar with? And you're mostly medical people, I guess, are familiar with X-rays and MRI and so on. So, what's strange about that picture?
We don't see the bone.
You don't see the bone. So why don't you see the bone? Anybody? Yeah.
Probably due to the scattering, so you don't see the structure, because they probably block the light, but then it's scattered around.
Okay. Answering the question also gets you off the hook from buying you here, so it's three people safe so far. And one of them is Dutch. There's a surprise.
Two.
Okay. Well, he's seen me drink before, so that's a good thing as well. Okay. So, anyway, the point is that you have a lot of scattering. I mean, imagine how much scattering it requires to end up with this kind of picture. So I'm talking really about a point source of light, basically an optical fiber, a tiny point of light, and this is the kind of image that you get. There is no evidence that there is a bone in that image. That tells me that the light is totally diffuse. And when we talk about diffuse light, this is what we mean. So if people talk to you about diffuse light imaging, diffuse optical imaging of the breast, for example, you know, they're talking about this kind of light. When we talk about diffuse, we mean that a photon now has no relationship to the original direction. Okay? So the original light contained here, the light coming out there is going in all directions equally. So it's like molecules in a tin can, you know, it's bouncing around in all directions, so it's diffusing around the place, right? So very heavily scattered. So within a millimeter, let's say, of tissue, the light photons bear no relationship to the original direction. That's what we mean by diffuse, and that is scattering. And scattering is actually the dominant mechanism for losing light within tissue. It's not absorption. It's scattering by two orders of magnitude, except for blue light and maybe to some extent the far end of green light. Scattering is the last mechanism for light within the tissue. Okay? So there was Turn Schrein's publication back in the 1960s, and things have moved on since then. we've heard already about the motivation and the importance of the microcirculation, and the microcirculation is the root, at the root of the mechanisms, and it is one of the earliest manifestations in some of the key epidemic diseases that we are faced, at least in the developed world. Okay? So, very important that we study this. And for the laser doppler system that Professor Ferenc talked about already, this had its origins, I suppose, in the mid-1970s with a paper in Nature by Mike Stern, but then it was really when Bonner and Russell came up with a sound theoretical basis for the measurement that several companies started to produce laser doppler instruments, and I believe all those companies are still alive and well and selling those instruments today. But I suppose one of the disappointments for me, and I was involved with the Oxford Optronics company, is that we haven't moved this in a very large way into the clinic yet. There's only a small number of applications. The one that I can think of is in burn depth assessment. So the severity of burns, as you will know, dictates how much of the skin you remove, how much you leave there. So if there's a high microcirculation activity, a high flow, you can generally leave that tissue because that will replace itself. The bit that's severely burned will have diminished flow, and you have to remove that because it will not be able to recover itself. And that's, to my knowledge, the only FDA diagnostic approved use of laser doppler at this point in time. But I guess for us in the physics world involved in developing laser doppler, it probably seems like an old technology. For people on the medical side receiving this technology, it may seem like a new technology, and they really have to take it on and prove the clinical usefulness of it. So in Amsterdam and in many other places, people have developed various kinds of microscopic means for looking at the microcirculation. Intravital microscopy of various types, and here I suppose is the state of the art. What used to be called optical polarization spectroscopy imaging, where basically you would use green light to illuminate the blood within, for example, the oral mucosa, the tongue, and so on. So why green light, anybody, in that context? So the vessels are quite close to the surface, and you're going to use green light because it's very heavily absorbed by the blood, the hemoglobin in the blood. So you get a very strong contrast between the surrounding tissue, and surrounding tissue essentially is white, okay? Like, irrespective of race or ethnic background, the tissue, once you take off the first 50 microns where the melanin layer is, the tissue without blood is essentially white. And anybody think about what white really means? What does it mean when something is white? Anybody?
It doesn't absorb any light.
It doesn't absorb any light? That's a very good answer. Yeah, another man off the hook. So it doesn't absorb any light. Yeah. Why is it different to a mirror?
Excuse me?
Why is it different to a mirror? Anybody else can answer to?
Because it scatters.
Because it scatters light. Very good. Another one. Right? I'm going to be all out of hunters here. It scatters the light. So the tissue that the light is interacting with is scattering. Okay? Mostly scattering. Remember that when you look at the skin, for example, only 1% of that is blood. We talk a lot about the blood in the skin and its impact on absorption. That's because the absorption is very high. But only, you know, unless they give you a slap on the face, and I'm not allowed to do that anymore, apparently. Is it 1100? Yeah, maybe not. So if I give you a slap on the face, maybe it's 1.5% because you have a little reaction. But generally, about 1% of your skin or 1.5% might be blood, okay? The first millimeter or so of the tissue. So it's not quite as big a component as you think. So all that surrounding tissue is a scattering matrix, and scattering the light around the place. So one of the problems when you do microscopy is generally you're using a light to illuminate the area that you want to image. And of course, the reflection from the surface and from parts that you're not so interested in tends to be very bright. And then the bit that you're interested in, like the vessels in this case, you know, are somewhere underneath that very bright surface. So one way around that was found by Cam Ince and Jean-Louis Vincent in Amsterdam and Belgium. And the way around it was to illuminate outside of the area that you're imaging. And in general, this is used not just in microcirculation imaging, but in general we call this dark field imaging. Right? Bright field imaging has its problems. Bright field imaging is what you might traditionally assume goes on. Dark field imaging is where you illuminate outside the field and the light gets scattered into the field, and then you illuminate what comes back from within there. And that's what you're doing here, the slice is coming down around the outside. Here's an image of my retina, which hopefully means if you spot any diseases there, maybe I don't want to know about them. But as far as I know, it's reasonably healthy looking retina. So we can see all these small vessels within the eye. And we can see those because there's no scattering between the lens, the cornea, the outside surface of the eye, and where that flow is happening at the back of the eye. And we were doing this basically to look at the effect of oxygen saturation on the vessel. So we wanted to see how much did those tiny little arteries dilate or not when the subject breathes 100% oxygen. And of course, when you have something like diabetes, the main thing that's happening within the vessels is that they lose their ability to react. So in diabetes, in general, in the microcirculation, and Professor Ferenc probably knows this, can tell you much better about this than I can, but as I understand it, the vessels are slightly hyperdilated, but they have no ability to expand beyond that. So when there's a demand on my retinal vessels for extra oxygen, if I had diabetes, they would not respond, and therefore I might go blind or whatever as a result of that lack of oxygen. You probably see get shown a lot of confocal fluorescent microscopy images, beautiful images of cells and other subcellular structures, maybe even. And that's wonderful, but when we want to, wonderful for development, or at least looking at drugs as they respond. As cells respond to them in petri dishes and so on. Of course, the biology that we're really interested in is the 3D in vivo biology as it happens within living organisms. And in that case, it's very hard to see more than 100 microns into any kind of tissue. This is a quite transparent tissue of a mouse embryo actually brought outside of the mouse. And you can see we have fluorescently labeled, so we have some dye on the blood cells, so you can see those cells moving, you can see the heart moving. This is about, I think, 10 days post-coitus, so very early stage development in the embryo. If you want to see deeper with fluorescent microscopy, you could, and you have a whole lot of says that only one photon is absorbed by one atom at a time, but it just so happens if you can get the two photons to arrive at exactly the same time, at exactly the same molecule, then they can be absorbed as though they were one photon with double the energy. And the importance of that basically is that it means that you can now put a focal spot down here in the middle of some medium without all this background noise that you would have from a traditional single photon fluorescent microscope. And Warren Zipfel and Chris Du, who visited me not so long ago, have been involved in the development of this over many years and are now doing three photon microscopy, which allows you to do even better. But the point is that you can get a focus much deeper within tissue, and so you can look at the mouse brain microcirculation up to 1 millimeter in depth within the tissue. And with three photon, it turns out that you can go using 1700 nanometer light, you can go maybe 1.5 millimeters into the tissue. So if you have lots of money and the ability to work with those kind of lasers, then you can get those kinds of images. One of the reasons that I got involved in this was I was asked by Guy Chaplin at the Gray Laboratories about how to assess the microcirculation as it is damaged by their anti-vascular drugs. They were experimenting on statins. I heard recently that we should all be taking statins. I'm not prescribing anything, I'm a physicist by the way, so think about that for yourself. But in any case, the idea was that they had tried out these drugs on 1 cubic millimeter tumors on the foot of a mouse, and I was talking at the same time with Garth Cruikshank at the general at the Western General in Glasgow, brain surgeon, and he said, well, last week I was presented with a 15-year-old girl with symptoms of a brain tumor, and I know when I go back to Glasgow we will have a diagnosis of brain tumor, and the tumor will be about the size of an egg. And you know, this stuff they're talking about, the drugs they're developing there, how am I going to know how much of that is going to be appropriate to treat this girl's tumor, and how do I know when it's working or if it's working? If it's affecting the microcirculation, we can use laser Doppler microprobes, which we did. So each of these probes has three measurement points along the shaft of a needle, and so here is the model of the tumor. So basically you have a tumor which is grown off from this vessel, and when they inject the drug, it goes preferentially into these immature endothelial cells. The endothelial cells in a tumor are immature because they've grown up very quickly, and they leak this drug into this endothelial cell. The endothelial cell swells up and chokes off the tumor. At least that's the theory. 15 years later, they're in stage 3 clinical trials, and they still have a company, it's in San Francisco, called Oxygen, but they still haven't sold a product. Yes, so it's a tough, very tough, tough business. So Professor Ferenc has already talked about laser Doppler, I think. To do laser Doppler scanning, you scan, raster scan the laser beam across the surface, and you can build up a picture of microcirculation. So in these images, red means fast flow, dark blue means very low flow, and it's graded up through the colors in between there. So in laser speckle, you can illuminate all of the tissue at the same time, and so you can look at the contrast produced by the speckles as a measure of flow. So I'm not sure how much you've explained this before, but basically we talked about talked about white scattering light. So if you have scattering objects, in other words, the tin oxide particles that are in that paint are about the right size, the wavelength of the light, 600 nanometers of this red light. So we get bright and dark spots, which we call speckles. And if I could hold my hand steady enough, you'd see that those speckles stay in the same place for as long as I can hold it there, right? But when we shine the light into human tissue, those speckles move around, and they're moving around because the blood cells are moving around within our tissue, right? So if you think about then taking a picture of those speckles, if you take a picture very slowly with a long exposure time, those speckles, because they're moving around, will tend to cancel each other out, so you'll have low contrast. But if you take it with a short exposure time, you will have high contrast, because the speckles won't have moved very much in that period of time. So the amount of contrast blurring, if you like, or blurring the speckles, tells you something about the movement of light, the movement of blood cells within the tissue. So it gives you an overview of movement of blood within the tissue. And there's an occlusion. Your arm looks blue because it's very low flow, and when you release that, you get a reactive hyperemia that Professor Ferenc has just told us about. Okay. Laser speckle, even if you use exactly the same wavelength and exactly the same camera as a similar laser Doppler system, will give you much more superficial images of the microcirculation. And there are various theories around why that is. One of the reasons may be that the deeper flow is much faster moving and doesn't contribute as much to laser speckle as it was to laser Doppler. Laser Doppler would be more sensitive to faster moving flow. Okay, so there's that image again, reminding us that absorption, but more importantly, scattering is affecting how the light is getting in and out of the tissue. And if we look from blue light around here all the way up to infrared light up there, we find that there is a lower absorption of all of these things, melanin, hemoglobin, oxyhemoglobin, even glucose is in there, but more importantly, collagen, proteins, and water, very strong absorption down this end. So doing any kind of imaging where you're trying to look at things which have a water content, which most human tissues do, it's going to be very difficult beyond about 1400 nanometers. At the other end, hemoglobin, oxy and deoxyhemoglobin, have very strong absorptions in the green and blue end of the spectrum. So somewhere in between here, you can get light in and out of the tissue to reasonable depths. Okay? And by reasonable, I mean that you can focus light to about 1 millimeter. We call that the soft limit of light penetration into tissue. You can get diffuse light to go 6 or even 7 millimeters into the tissue. Okay? So if you want a focused an image based on focusing light, you're always going to be restricted to the top 1 millimeter at best. If you want to go deeper than that, you have to use diffuse light. Okay? So here is maybe an accumulation of that data, which tells us here is the far end of what you can see in the blue, 400 nanometers. Below that, you have very severe scattering, absorption, I should say. Absorption, you can see 10 or 20 per centimeter. In other words, you have 10 or 20 chances that the photon will be absorbed in every centimeter it travels. So maybe 1 in 10 is going to survive more than a centimeter in the blue end of the regime. The red end of the regime, you have more or less 50-50 chance of absorption survival per centimeter. But scattering is much more important. Look at how much bigger the numbers are. They're in the hundreds, so orders of magnitude bigger losses of light due to scattering. And so if we look at breast tissue, okay, just to remind you, this is the blue end of what you can see with your eye, and this is the red end of what you can see with your eye. So from somewhere here around the red range up to 1350 nanometers in the infrared end of things, you can get a lot of light into the tissue and back out. This is a log scale, so this is orders of magnitude, right? 10, 100, 1000. So very big differences down here due to water, very high absorption once you go beyond